From the UN Climate Summit in Katowice, Poland, this is Democracy Now!
Just answer the question, what is the U.S. doing here since President Trump said he's pulling out of the Paris Agreement? Can you talk about President Trump's saying that climate change is a Chinese hoax?
Story. A top energy advisor to President Trump here at the UN climate talks tries to run away as Democracy Now! Questions him.
If you just answer a few questions.
I'm going to wait for you. Give me your card. I can have our folks reach out. Maybe we can do some questions. But you're actually harassing me.
A reporter asking you a question, sir, is not harassment.
This came a day after protesters laughed at the same Trump advisor, Wells Griffith, who chaired a U.S. panel promoting the use of coal and other fossil fuels. But first, we hear from a Filipina climate activist who lost five members of her family 5 years ago during Typhoon Haiyan.
For those who experienced Haiyan, the strongest typhoon ever recorded, it was apocalyptic. I witnessed my mother, my father, brother, sister-in-law, and my three-year-old nephew being swept away by the storm surge. It left my brother and me to search for our family's bodies in the aftermath.
Joanna Sustento is now focusing her fight against climate change on the world's biggest polluters, the carbon majors, the 47 fossil fuel companies responsible for nearly a quarter of all greenhouse gases emitted. Plus, we speak with the Indian climate activist Harjit Singh of ActionAid. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. President Trump threatened to shut down the government during a contentious and openly hostile meeting with Democratic congressional leaders Nancy Pelosi and Senator Chuck Schumer in the Oval Office Tuesday. The meeting, which took place in front of reporters and television cameras, centered around the ongoing dispute over funding for Trump's border wall.
The fact is, you do not have the votes in the House.
Nancy, I do. And we need border security.
Let's take the vote,
Nancy,
we'll find out.
Nancy, we need border security. It's very simple.
Of course we do.
We need border security.
We do.
People are pouring into our country, including terrorists. We have terrorists. We caught 10 terrorists over the last very short period of time. 10.
We want to do the same thing we did last year, this year. That's our proposal. If it's good then, it's good now, and it won't shut down the government.
Chuck, if we don't get what we want, one way or the other, whether it's through you, through a military, through anything you want to call, I will shut down the government.
Okay,
absolutely.
Fair enough.
And I am proud, and I'll tell you what, I am proud to shut down the government for border security, Chuck.
President Trump and Congress will have to agree on a spending bill by December 21st in order to avert a shutdown. In Britain, Prime Minister Theresa May is facing a leadership challenge after members of her Conservative Party triggered a vote of no confidence. Conservative lawmakers are set to vote today. If May loses, she would have to step down immediately. The vote comes as May is facing major hurdles in trying to pass a Brexit deal. Earlier this week, she halted a parliamentary vote on the deal after she failed to garner sufficient support within her own party. In France, a gunman shot and killed three people, injuring at least 12 others at an outdoor Christmas market in the northeast city of Strasbourg. The gunman is still on the loose. It's believed he may have fled to nearby Germany. France has issued the highest level of security alert. The subject was reportedly under investigation by French authorities. In Brazil, a gunman opened fire in a cathedral in the southern city of Campinas on Tuesday, killing four before turning the gun on himself. Police say they don't know the motive of the killer. Brazil's incoming president, Jair Bolsonaro, campaigned on loosening gun laws. Gun deaths in the country reached an all-time high last year, with more than 63,000 recorded homicides. In more news from Brazil, two men belonging to the landless workers movement, known as MST, were killed cooled over the weekend in the northeast state of Paraíba. The group says armed men entered an MST camp Saturday night and shot the two men dead over a land dispute. California Congressmember Ro Khanna responded to the news by tweeting, "Brazil's Bolsonaro has referred to land rights defenders as terrorists, and now over the weekend, two of their activists were assassinated. The U.S. must call on Bolsonaro to stop inciting violence and for Brazil to bring those guilty of this heinous crime to justice." In environmental news, a new report released this week warns of the devastating effects of illegal mining for gold and other minerals in the Amazon. The report found over 2,300 illegal mining sites in six countries. Mining activity has devastating social and environmental impacts, displacing indigenous communities and exposing people, wildlife, and plant life to extremely high levels of mercury. Scientists have issued a new warning on Arctic warming. A report released this week finds the Arctic has been warmer over the last 5 years than at any time since 1900, the year record-keeping began. The region is warming at twice the rate of the rest of the planet. In San Francisco, 300 climate activists from the Sunrise Movement demonstrated the California office of Congressmember and likely incoming House Speaker Nancy Pelosi one day after over 1,000 activists flooded Capitol Hill, calling for Congress to form a Green New Deal Select Committee.
We're seeing the impacts of climate change. Just a few weeks ago, the campfires were making it hard to breathe in here and took over 85 lives. And we need to be treating climate change like a crisis, because it is a crisis. And as young people, we have a lot at stake in this.
The number of Congress members supporting the Green New Deal, proposed by incoming New York Congressmember Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, has jumped to 35, up from 22 since the start of organizing actions this week. Newly released data shows Immigration and Customs Enforcement has arrested 170 people since July who had offered to sponsor unaccompanied migrant minors who were being held in government custody. Sponsors are most commonly relatives of unaccompanied children who would be able to take them into their care. In the majority of cases, those arrested had no criminal record. In September, ICE confirmed it was arresting potential sponsors for possible immigration violations. In November, there were more than 14,000 immigrant children in government custody, a record high. In more immigration news, an Arizona judge has issued a deportation order for the well-known immigrant rights and reproductive justice leader, Alejandra Pablos. Earlier this year, Pablos was detained by ICE for more than 40 days after reporting to a routine check-in. Many believe she was targeted for her activism. She appeared on Democracy Now! In April.
Trump has his own personal police force, which is ICE. They're enacting all his white supremacist agenda. People, all our community right now are being deported, especially working people and, like you said, activists. And I was simply detained because of an arrest at a peaceful protest in Virginia. I haven't even been convicted.
Alejandra Pablos has vowed to appeal her deportation. In Texas, a judge accepted a plea deal from a former Baylor University fraternity president who was indicted on 4 counts of sexual assault, allowing him to avoid prison time. Under the deal, 24-year-old Jacob Walter Anderson will receive probation and counseling and has to pay a $400 fine. He will not have to register as a sex offender. After news of the plea deal broke, the survivor of Anderson's attack wrote, quote, "This guy violently raped me multiple times, choked me, and when I blacked out, he dumped me face down on the ground and left me to die. When I woke up aspirating up my own vomit, my friends immediately took me to the hospital," she said. Meanwhile, public outrage is growing over the case of Cyntoia Brown, who's currently serving a life sentence after being convicted of first-degree murder after shooting her rapist. Brown was sexually trafficked and repeatedly abused and drugged. The shooting happened when she was just 16 years old, but Brown was tried as an adult. Last week, the Tennessee Supreme Court ruled Brown must serve 51 years of her sentence before she becomes eligible for parole. Tennessee Governor Bill Haslam said Monday he's considering clemency for Cyntoia Brown. In Charlottesville, Virginia, a jury sentenced self-described neo-Nazi James Alex Fields to life in prison for killing anti-fascist protester Heather Heyret last year's white supremacist Unite the Right rally. Fields was convicted of first-degree murder by the jury Friday. A judge will formally sentence Fields on March 29th. He can impose a less severe punishment than the jurors, but is not allowed to increase the sentence, according to Virginia law. In New York, demonstrators gathered in front of the office of the Anti-Defamation League to protest what's known as the deadly exchange between Israeli and U.S. law enforcement agencies. The ADL has come under fire from activists for sponsoring law enforcement training exchanges between the two countries. This is one of the protesters at Monday night's gathering organized by Jewish Voice for Peace.
We're over 300 Jews and our friends. We've gathered together to call on the ADL to end its police exchanges between the U.S. and Israel. The ADL funds and organizes exchanges between U.S. police who go to Israel to train with the Israeli military. This is an exchange of worst practices, of profiling, of surveillance and violence. And the ADL, which claims to be a civil rights organization, has no business training police.
And celebrated documentary filmmaker Bill Siegel has died. Siegel co-directed the Oscar-nominated film Weather Underground and directed the Emmy Award-winning The Trials of Muhammad Ali, which examines the struggle legendary boxer Muhammad Ali faced after he converted to Islam and refused to fight in Vietnam, and his following years in exile before returning to the ring. You can see our 2013 interview with Bill Siegel at democracynow.org. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. We're broadcasting from the UN Climate Summit in Katowice, Poland, just an hour's drive from Krakow, and about the same distance from Auschwitz, the largest Nazi concentration camp of World War II. Nearly a million Jews died in the camp. Here in Katowice, world leaders are gathered for the final few days of the 24th annual UN Climate Conference. Officials from nearly 200 countries are here to negotiate how to implement the 2015 Paris Agreement. But 3 years after Paris, countries appear no closer to curbing global emissions and halting catastrophic climate change. New studies show global carbon emissions may have risen as much as 3.7% in 2018, marking the second annual increase in a row. One recent report likened rising emissions to a, quote, speeding freight train. As the UN Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change reports that humanity has only a dozen years to mitigate climate change or face global catastrophe, we begin today's show with a woman who's already felt the harrowing effects of climate change, is dedicating her life to climate activism as a result. Joanna Sustento's life was turned upside down in 2013 when Typhoon Haiyan, one of the strongest cyclones in recorded history, devastated her country, the Philippines, killing five members of her family and thousands of others. This is Joanna telling her story to Greenpeace Philippines.
From the biggest of tragedies, hope can be found. My name is Joanna Sustento. I had a happy life, a good job, great friends, and a wonderful, loving family. But in a matter of minutes, all of that changed. For those who experienced Haiyan, the strongest typhoon ever recorded, it was apocalyptic. I witnessed my mother, my father, brother, sister-in-law, and my three-year-old nephew being swept away by the storm surge. It left my brother and me to search for our family's bodies in the aftermath. We never found our father and our nephew. It's difficult to be the one left behind. You have to deal with all the questions, the grief, the pain, and the regrets. Typhoon Haiyan killed more than 10,000 people and left over 14 million people homeless. But it's not just statistics and numbers in a news report. This is about us, the people.
Filipina climate activist Joanna Sustento. Since Typhoon Haiyan, she's focused her fight against climate change on the world's biggest polluters. They're called the Carbon Majors, the 47 fossil fuel companies responsible for nearly a quarter of all greenhouse gases. She says they're legally responsible for the death of her family members. She's here in Katowice, Poland, for the UN Climate Summit. Joanna Sestento, welcome to Democracy Now!
Thank you for having me.
Oh, I remember so vividly 5 years ago when we were actually here in the same country, Poland, in Warsaw, when Yebsanyo, who was heading the Philippines delegation, spoke to the world. We're going to play that in a minute. But if you can talk about where you were on that day and tell us what happened.
So 5 years ago, on November 8, 2013, I was actually at home with my family. So there was seven of us living in that house. And as early as 5 a.m., we were already awake because of the strong wind and the rain. And it was in the Philippines, we experience an average of 20 typhoons per year. But it was the first time that we felt such intensity to the point that we can feel our house vibrate because of the pressure. And there was a distinct howling in the wind that was, we've never experienced that before. And that was also the time when it was the first time we experienced storm surge for, the height was like 15 to 20 feet. We had no choice but to go out of our house.
And you were with?
I was with my parents, my eldest brother, my two of my older brothers, my sister-in-law, and my three-year-old nephew. There were seven of us in that house. So basically, we didn't have a choice but to just go out of the house, because if we stay there, we would be trapped inside. And we got separated from each other while battling the strong winds, the rain, and the storm surge. And in just 2 hours, everything was damaged. Everything was taken away from us.
Had water risen?
Yes. It rose for about 15 to 20 feet.
Who were you with outside?
My whole family. We decided to go out of the house.
And you were holding on to each other?
We were holding on to our window grills. And then the strategy was we would wait for the storm surge to rise up to the roof so it would be easier for us to go up. But since there were plenty of debris floating, animals like birds, frogs, snakes, rats were floating with us in the surge. And it was hitting us as well. We couldn't also see what was really happening because everything was so hazy, and it was as if crushed ice were being thrown at our face. So at some point, all of us were separated from each other, but I was together with my parents during their last minutes of their lives. I saw my father while we were floating and we were holding onto a log. My father drowned, and then he surfaced, and then I saw him drown again, and then he surfaced, and then he drowned, and then I never saw him again. And that's when I focused myself on my mom. There was a refrigerator floating in front of us. So I decided to grab onto the refrigerator so that we could stay afloat. So my mom held onto it as well. But the waves were so strong, it was crashing onto the refrigerator, and I was being pushed under the steel trusses of a building nearby our house. So the water was, the steel trusses of the building was up here on my head, and the water
above
was up
you.
Here.
And water was to your nose.
Yes, I was being trapped. So I decided to just push the refrigerator away from the building and hold on to it. And I looked for other things to keep me afloat. But that's when my mom and I got separated from each other. And I felt like I was being spun inside a washing machine. It was very hard for me to surface again because there were plenty of debris blocking my head. I tried to surface, but I just couldn't. And at some point, it was very exhausting for me to try to survive. But I felt that when I pushed my head, I felt air. So I just used both my hands to push all the things that were blocking my head. And I actually used, I think it was a door, I'm not sure. I used the thing that was blocking my head to float. So then I saw my mom and I drifted towards her. I held her arms and I tried to lift half of her body so she could hold onto the wood I was using to stay afloat. But when my hand slipped from her arms to her fingers, her body splashed into the water and there was just no sign of her struggling to survive. So I just hugged her and I kept on calling her, but she didn't respond anymore. And that's when I realized that my mom was gone. I just held on to her and let the storm surge take us. And then at some point, it was very exhausting to be carrying her lifeless body. And that I had to make a decision if I am going to hold on to my mom, I would also die because the current of the water was very strong. But if I let her go, I will live. But will I ever be able to live with that decision that I wasn't able to save what was left of my family?
But your mother was dead.
So I decided that I was able to survive that storm, and my parents would want me to continue and to choose to be alive despite all of that. So I had no choice but to just let her go. And then I just climbed up the steel frames of a water tank and I stayed there until the wind and the water receded, and then someone just helped me come down from the steel frames. And then I asked what time it was, and he said that it was about 9 a.m. And then I remembered that the water started to rise in our house. It was 7, so it was 2 hours.
In fact, 10,000 people died in that 2 hours.
More than 10,000 people died.
And your other family members, your brothers, your nephew?
My eldest brother, his wife, and his son, they weren't able to survive the storm either. So right now, it's just me and my older brother.
At that time that you were struggling for your life, the UN summit was taking place right here in Poland. And Yebsanyo was beside himself. Yebsanyo, the Philippines' top climate negotiator 5 years ago. This is Yeb addressing the 2013 UN Climate Conference in Warsaw just after the Typhoon Haiyan devastated the Philippines.
Such as Haiyan and its impacts represent a sobering reminder to the international community that we cannot afford to delay climate action. Warsaw must deliver on enhancing ambition and should muster the political will to address climate change and build that important bridge towards Peru and Paris. It might be said that it must be poetic justice that the Typhoon Haiyan was so big that its diameter spanned the distance between Warsaw and Paris. Mr. President, in Doha, we asked, if not us, then who? If not now, then when? If not here, then where? But here, in Warsaw, we may very well ask these same forthright questions. What my country is going through as a result of this extreme climate event is madness. The climate crisis is madness. Mr. President, we can stop this madness right here in Warsaw.
That was Yeb Sanyo speaking as the lead climate negotiator for the Philippines in 2013. Through that UN climate summit, he wept. He fasted. The next year, the UN climate summit was held in Lima, Peru. And just before he was headed to Peru, he learned he would no longer be on the delegation. Our guest is Joanna Sustento, climate activist from Tacloban. Also, Yeb did not know what had happened to his family members, and your family knew Yeb's family.
Yes. Yeb's brother, A.G. Sanyo, is actually my brother's friend. And A.G. was supposed to stay at our house the night before the typhoon struck. But he decided to stay in a hotel, and I couldn't imagine if A.G. was in our house and he would also experience the same extent of the struggle to survive.
In fact, we spoke with both A.G. and Yeb in the coming summits as they describe their own experience.
Yes.
You have called Typhoon Haiyan a violation of human rights. Talk about that. Why?
Typhoon Haiyan and all the other storms that passed after Haiyan as a result of climate change is a violation of human rights, because whenever extreme weather events happen, especially in my country, the Philippines, we lose the basic human right to a safe environment. We use the right to live. We lose the right to live. We lose our right to livelihood. We lose our right to education because schools get damaged. And whenever there are typhoon warnings, our classes get suspended. And can you imagine, students having to go through that? We lose our human dignity. To just have that mental health. Because after the storm, we did not have that space to grieve and to just feel what we want to feel. We lost everything, but we didn't have that space because we were so busy for survival. Hmm. We were busy looking for food, for water, for family members.
So talk about how you went from this climate catastrophe, a climate survivor, losing five members of your family, to becoming a climate activist, coming to global gatherings like these, and now taking on what's called the carbon majors, the 47 fossil fuel companies that are responsible for some quarter of the fossil fuels emitted through history, fossil fuel emissions.
Well, I can say that what we've experienced back home, Typhoon Haiyan, it became that turning point, because a year after the onslaught of Haiyan, we were again anticipating another super typhoon. And as I remember, as I was packing my things, because we were preparing to evacuate to a safer place, I just felt so exhausted. And I just thought, is this it? Is this the life that I'm going to be living from now on? Are we just going to wait for another catastrophe to happen? Are we just going to count the casualties, the injured, the missing? Are we just going to wait for relief and aid from foreign countries every time we are met by these catastrophes? And I cannot imagine living a life like that. It's exhausting. It's a great injustice, because we are not responsible for this. I do not want my future family, my future children, to go through what I've been through, because no one deserves that. And that's when I realized that everything was taken away by that storm. But I was able to survive that for a reason. And I promised myself that I will never stop finding what that reason is. Sorry. And I realized that despite everything, our community, we have gained a powerful story to tell. Because our experiences, our stories, it could put a human face on the numbers, on the statistics of climate change. And I believe that these global conferences, human stories have that power to change the current system.
Right now, a human rights commission in the Philippines is trying to determine if corporate polluters should be held accountable for the loss of life linked to their business model. Can you describe this investigation that's underway and also a lawsuit against the carbon majors?
This petition was filed in the year 2015 by typhoon survivors, fisher folk, farmers, and other environmental organizations at the Commission on Human Rights of the Philippines to investigate 47 oil, coal, and gas companies into their responsibility for human rights violations resulting from climate change. Now it is already the sixth public hearing in the Philippines, actually. So we gather scientists, researchers who have the facts backed by climate science.
And what you say to people who say you can never prove any one hurricane is related to climate change?
Yes, of course.
And yet, the intensity, the frequency.
Yes. It has been getting more extreme, getting more frequent. And with the help of our community witnesses in the Philippines, they are also put to the stand, and they have the chance to share how climate change impacted their lives, their livelihood, their...
Companies tried to shut down the investigation, some of these fossil fuel companies?
So far, none of them have showed up. So they are blatantly ignoring as what they've been doing for the past decades. Because they knew of the consequences of their business practices, but they didn't do it. Well, they did something about it. They paid billions of dollars to individuals so that they deny climate science. And that's just... They blatantly deceived the whole world.
Have you been participating in some of the protests here? And also the issue that's so interesting of protests that are taking place, yet those who protest in this conference center in Poland, this is part of a UN deal, mm-hmm. a conference center that, by the way, is shaped like a coal mine and sits on an old coal mine, a whole coal mine area. Protesters are not allowed to name names of corporations they're protesting.
I have been participating, like, in the climate march. I saw that. I've also seen plenty of activists with whom I share the same advocacy. And
can you name some of the names of the companies, the 47 carbon majors?
Shell, BP, Chevron, ExxonMobil, Suncor, Lukoil. That's just some of the 40s. Well, there are actually 90 big companies all over the world. But 47 companies are present in the Philippines.
We just have 30 seconds left. What do you want to see come out of this conference and talk about your life's dedication at this point, your life's mission?
Honestly, at this point, I am not expecting anything from the COP, but having journeyed with fellow activists here, I see that there is so much power in the people out there. There is so much power for them to create that pressure to our governments, to our corporations to change the current system. And through their stories, through our stories, we can change that global mindset.
I want to thank you so much for being with us. Again, our condolences for your family, for the Philippines, and for so many other countries. We're going to talk more about this all through this week as we broadcast from the UN Climate Summit. Joanna Sustento, climate activist from Tacloban, Philippines, Typhoon Haiyan survivor, lost 5 members of her family, and so many more in her community. This is Democracy Now! When we come back, chasing the story, Democracy Now! Tries to question a top climate advisor to President Trump. Stay with us. Thank you.
Sa bayan, likha ng usok sa pagawaan. To'y di mo masilayan.
Hang and Win by Asin here on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. We're broadcasting from the UN Climate Summit here in Katowice, Poland. Protesters on Monday disrupted an event hosted by the Trump administration promoting coal and fossil fuels. It was the only public event hosted by the United States during the summit. The event featured Wells Griffith, special assistant to the president for international energy and environment. Griffith is a longtime Republican operative who served as deputy chief of staff to Rens Priebus when Priebus was chair of the Republican National Committee. Climate activists disrupted Griffith's speech minutes after he began speaking.
Over a year and a half ago, President Trump announced the United States' intent to withdraw from the Paris Agreement unless suitable terms for re-engagement are identified. We strongly believe that no country should have to sacrifice economic prosperity or energy security in pursuit of environmental sustainability. The United States is now the number one combined oil and gas producer in the world. If we are serious about eradicating poverty and providing universal access to affordable, reliable energy, it is clear that energy innovation and fossil fuels will continue to play a leading role. Energy access.
Over here are illusionists. They have a show of smoke and mirrors. They come here to sell. And ultimately, they're carbon or climate deniers and carbon and nuclear energy profiteers. Shame on you.
We're going to continue going. I think that was another example of all too often we can't have an open and honest discussion about the realities. And it was actually fitting that the interruption began during the energy access portion that we were discussing. In addition to economic growth, energy security, and eradicating energy poverty, all energy sources are important, and they will be utilized unapologetically.
Hi, my name's Christy Drutman. I'm from Oakland, California, and I am one of the leads with Sustain Us's media team this year. And this action, we basically wanted to make a mockery of the Trump administration promoting fossil fuels here at COP24 this year in Poland. So we made a display. Everyone in the audience laughed. We did a walkout. We did chants and speeches featuring frontline and indigenous community members who are really pushing for real solutions to climate change, which involves putting fossil fuels in the ground and transitioning to renewable energy and focusing on community-led solutions to our climate crisis.
My name is Monica Araya, and I'm an activist from Costa Rica. We just witnessed something very backward, which is a male panel talking about something that doesn't exist. They talk about clean fossil fuels, but we know that doesn't exist. So that's something that, you know, makes you scratch your head. But the other thing that was remarkable is that they talk as if science doesn't exist. They talk as if the burning of those fossil fuels doesn't have impacts. And in essence, they are optimizing their own industry, because it was all about optimization of an industry that we know has to say goodbye.
All power to the people!
All power to the people!
Show me what community looks like!
This is what community
the
looks
voices
like.
Of protesters here at the UN climate talks in Katowice, Poland, disrupting an event hosted by the United States to promote coal and other fossil fuels. The action began when protesters started laughing at one of the speakers, the chair of the event, Trump advisor Wells Griffith, a longtime Republican operative who serves as special assistant to the president for international energy and environment. Griffith served as deputy chief of staff to Rents Priebus when Priebus was chair of the Republican National Committee. I ran into Wells Griffith on Tuesday here at the UN climate talks and attempted to ask him about the Trump administration's climate policy. Griffith immediately began walking and then running away.
Hi, I'm Amy Goodman from Democracy.
Sorry.
Can you
I've
tell?
Go.
Oh no, we came to your report.
I've got to go to another meeting.
Can you tell us what you think about President Trump saying climate change is a hoax?
Excuse me.
You can answer the question. Are you not speaking to the press here?
I'm sorry, I'm running late for a meeting. Thanks.
Right, but you weren't running late when you're just standing there. So just answer the question, what is the U.S. doing here since President Trump said he's pulling out of the Paris Agreement? Can you talk about President Trump's saying that climate change is a Chinese hoax? Are you not talking to the press while you're here?
Maybe we can set up something up later with our press.
Who would I talk to? Can I ask if you agree with President Trump calling climate change a hoax? You're definitely giving me a run for my money here. Can you talk about why the U.S. is here, since President Trump is saying he's pulling the U.S. out of the Paris Climate Accord? Can you talk about why you are pushing coal? No answer on any issue? Can you talk about why the U.S. would not welcome the U.N. report saying that catastrophic climate change is imminent and the U.S., the world has to wean itself off of coal by 2050?
I'll connect you with our press folks if you want to give me a card, and I'll have them reach out.
We could have spoken this whole time. I don't hold out much hope for you to grant an interview. But if you could answer the question about whether you agree with President Trump calling climate change a hoax. Can you explain why the U.S. is even at the climate summit, given that he's pulling out? Can you explain why the U.S. joined with Saudi Arabia and not well in watering down language around the UN report.
Wells Griffith begins to climb a set of stairs, then suddenly reverses course, comes back down, and darts past the various country pavilion exhibits.
Wells Griffith, can you talk about why the U.S. is pushing coal at this UN climate summit? Can you talk about the U.S. role here at the UN climate summit? Why the U.S. is present at all? Can you explain why you won't comment on any issue yet you're here?
If I give you a card, I can do it, but you're really bad.
What's that?
If you give me a card, I can have her.
If you just answer a few questions.
I won't wait for it. If you give me a card, I can have our folks reach out. Maybe we can do some questions, but you're actually harassing me. But
can you explain why you won't answer any questions on the issue of climate change or why the U.S. is here?
If you would like to set up an interview, we can do that. I just would need your contact information.
A reporter asking you a question, sir, is not harassment.
That's not what's happening.
Why not answer a few simple questions?
I could set something up if you would give me your contact information.
So you're saying you will do an interview?
I'm saying I'll get with our press folks and we'll...
Well, why don't you give me your card? Why don't you give me your card and we'll set something up?
I asked for yours. I'd be happy to get you in touch with our press folks. But you're following me around now.
Yeah. All right. I just want to get a few answers. It would take a few minutes.
Wells Griffith further accelerates, sprinting up another set of stairs, taking two steps at a time.
Mr. Griffith, can you just explain why the U.S. joined with Saudi Arabia to not welcome, to demand that the word welcome come out of... Oh, thank you. Okay. I thought you wanted to get me contact information. Well, we're standing in front of the United States of America delegation office. We followed Wells Griffith, who is a representative of the Trump administration, formerly a top aide to Rens Priebus, to ask him about the U.S. side program yesterday, where they pushed coal and fossil fuels at the U.N. climate summit. And I went up to him and asked him what he thinks of President Trump saying climate change is a hoax. I asked about why the United States is here at the U.N. climate summit, given that President Trump... Wait, I have to take my breath. Hi. Can you say who you are?
Email at...
Let me take the card.
ClimateCom.
You're not going to give me the card? He said someone would give me a card. Sir. You're not going to give me a card? So, a representative of the U.S. government just was about to hand me a card and then decided against handing me a card. Well, Wells Griffith said they would allow us to get a contact, so we'll just wait here and see what's happening.
A formal request for Trump advisor Wells Griffith to do an interview. His office just responded, "Sorry, but due to time constraints, Mr. Griffith is not available for this interview," unquote. One question many climate activists have is about Wells Griffith's qualifications to advise President Trump on climate and energy issues. In March, the publication E&E reported, quote, "Griffith's time at his dad's gas station is about all the energy experience he had until this past year when he landed a top political job at the Energy Department after working on the Trump campaign," unquote. In 2013, Griffith filmed a campaign ad for at his father's Shell station in Mobile, Alabama, in his failed attempt to run for Congress.
My parents taught me to look to the Bible, the Constitution, for wisdom and guidance in life. But this document, Obamacare, this is why I'm running for Congress. because we won't get back to creating jobs until these thousands of pages of economic destruction are relegated to the trash pile of history.
Wells Griffith did not win his campaign for Congress, but he has become a top energy advisor to President Trump. When we come back, we'll talk about what the United States is doing behind the scenes here with a top climate activist. Stay with us. Goodbye by the Beatles. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. We're broadcasting from the UN Climate Summit in Katowice, Poland. We end today's show looking at how the world's worst emitters are hindering negotiations at the UN Climate Summit here in Poland, even as countries from the global south warned that they could face annihilation without drastic action to confront climate change. On Tuesday, the island of Vanuatu's foreign prime minister, Ralph Reginvanu, criticized the United States and other big polluters for obstructing climate talks.
It pains me deeply to have watched the people of the United States and other developed countries across the globe suffering the devastating impacts of climate-induced tragedies, while their professional negotiators are here at COP24 putting red lines through any mention of loss and damage in the Paris guidelines and square brackets around any possibility for truthfully and accurately reporting progress against humanity's most existential threat. It frustrates me to see those countries historically responsible for climate change, refusing to operationalize the legal obligations to assist developing countries in their efforts to achieve sustainable development and adapt to climate change.
That was Vanuatu's foreign minister. Yesterday, I asked Trump advisor Wells Griffith what the U.S. is doing here at the U.N. Climate Summit.
What is the U.S. doing here since President Trump said he's pulling out of the Paris Agreement? Can you talk about President Trump's saying that climate change is a Chinese hoax?
Our next guest has been observing how the U.S. and other big polluters are hindering climate talks here in Katowice. Harjit Singh is the global lead on climate change for ActionAid. He's been working with climate migrants in several countries based in New Delhi, India. Welcome to Democracy Now!, Harjit. So I tried to get an answer from one of the top U.N. so-called climate advisors to President Trump. He wouldn't answer what they're doing here because they're pulling out of the talks. But in fact, they're very active behind the scenes. Is that right?
Absolutely. And it's very frustrating to see United States enjoying seat at the table, and they are using every single opportunity to destroy Paris Agreement. They're colluding with Australia, Canada, Japan, and their friends like Saudi Arabia to make sure that we don't make any progress on increasing our ambition on emission reduction. They're making sure that not a single penny goes from their side to developing countries who have to transition their economies, make them greener, and also tackle climate impacts. So we are not going to see rule book coming up here the way we expected.
So explain what happened. This weekend, the U.S. joined with Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia in the U.S., I mean, many Congress members are Republican and Democrat senators are deeply concerned about its involvement with the murder of a journalist, Jamal Khashoggi. But this weekend, they joined again with Saudi Arabia, their ally, in saying they wouldn't welcome the UN report on catastrophic climate change. They would only note it. Is this just language semantics, or does it really make a difference?
So this is crazy. Imagine this these parties had actually commissioned this report to IPCC, and then you kind of don't welcome it. You just note it, which means we are going to ignore the findings. So it's a political message that we don't accept the findings. And it's not for the first time. Saudi Arabia made everybody's life difficult in Korea when the summary for the policymakers was being developed in October. So it's not for the first time it joined the U.S. in diluting the findings of the report. Now, the world has accepted the seriousness of this report and is beginning to act. But somehow, Saudi Arabia and the U.S. are trying to undermine the importance of this very important report for us.
So when you talk about the rule book in these last minutes we have, what does that mean for a global community that doesn't understand U.N. speak?
Yeah. So in Paris, we came up with this agreement, which largely talks about what we are going to do to keep the temperature below 1.5 and help developing countries to adapt, which means, you know, retrofitting their houses, building dikes, and keep their people safe, to put it simply. But now, here in Katowice, we have to talk about how and who does how much. It's about making rules so that we are able to move forward on reducing emissions, but also help developing countries tackle climate impacts. And rule book is going to be fundamental in determining whether Paris Agreement is real or not, and how we raise our ambition going forward.
So the U.S. is pulling out of the Paris talks, but it takes a few years, not until 2020. And meanwhile, they're here, actually not absent, right, but very active. Specifically, what are they targeting behind the scenes?
This is so frustrating. U.S. is setting the rules of a game which it is not going to play at all. So it is watering down the text. That means rule book is going to be much weaker on providing finance to developing countries. Let us understand that finance happens to be at the center of everything that we are talking about. Developing countries have put their plans for on the table. It may cost trillions. What we are demanding at this moment is just $100 billion per year by 2020. And that money is to leverage trillions. If that amount of money is not going to be made available, all those plans that developing countries have put on the table are not going to be implemented.
In this last minute, talk about climate migrants. We just talked to someone from the Philippines, a survivor of Hurricane Hayat, though many in her family did not survive. What is the scope of this problem?
It's a very dire situation. Internal Displacement Monitoring Center, based in Geneva, came up with a report that in 2017, just in 135 countries, we had 18.8 million new displacements. And these migrants are increasing. And imagine this is just 1 degree warmer world that we are living in. And Paris Agreement is taking us to a 3 degree warmer world. The recent report from IPCC talked about how that even 1.5 degree is going to be so devastating.
1.5 degrees Celsius, 2.7 degrees Fahrenheit.
That's right. So even 0.5 degree difference means we are going to lose coral reefs forever. You know, the basis of marine ecology. Half of the plant and animal species are going to be extinct by end of century due to climate change in the most important natural spaces like Amazon. Now, what does that mean? That means people who are depending on that ecosystem, people are going to lose their land. If I talk about Bangladesh, they will lose 20% of their land to sea. And it's one of the most populated countries. What will happen to those people? Where are they going to go? There is no protection mechanism in place, neither in their country nor internationally, because some are forced to cross borders. Unlike refugees, they have no protection system in place. So this process has to deliver.
We're going to do part two of this discussion, posted online at democracynow.org. Harjit Singh, global lead on climate change at ActionAid. He's been working with climate migrants in a number of countries based in New Delhi, India. And that does it for our show. We have a media job opening as a full-time social media manager in New York City. Resumes are submit to democracynow.org. I'm Amy Goodman with a whole team here in Katowice, Poland. We're broadcasting for the week.